बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम। टुडे वी विल बी डिस्कसिंग माइलोप्रोलिफेरेटिव डिसऑर्डर्स। फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल द लर्निंग ऑब्जेक्टिव ऑफ द माइलोप्रोलिफेरेटिव डिसऑर्डर्स आर एट द एंड ऑफ द लेक्चर यू विल बी एबल टू डिफाइन द पॉलीसाइथीमिया रूब्रावेरा, एसेंशियल थ्रोम्बोसाइटोसिस एंड क्रॉनिक माइलोफाइब्रोसिस। And you will be able to describe the clinical manifestations of the same myeloproliferative disorders. And you will also be able to know the complications of these disorders and treatment modality, different modalities of the myeloproliferative disorders. And finally, you will be well aware of the prognosis of the myeloproliferative neoplasia or disorders. You know, in the genesis of the lymphoproliferative and myeloproliferative disorders, the first hematopoietic stem cell is divided into two series. First one is the lymphoid progenitor cell, which produces the lymphoproliferative disorders, and second one is the myeloid progenitor cell, which further divides into about six cells, including mast cells, erythrocytes, platelets, eosinophils, and neutrophils. And monocytes. These all cells can produce the malignancies, and the malignancies are written opposite to the same cells. First, the mast cells, it can produce a malignancy known as systemic mastocytosis, and the RBCs can produce the malignancy polycythemia vera. Similarly, the platelets malignancy can be essential thrombocytosis, and hyper eosinophilic syndrome is produced by abnormal proliferation of the eosinophils. And chronic myeloid leukemia, a well-known disease of the neutrophils, and similarly the myelomonocytic leukemia belongs to the monocytes. And finally, the myelofibrosis, which falls, which is related to the all of the myeloproliferative disorders, but it is beyond the division of the cells, and but ultimately, because the marrow gets fibrosed, and the reason being that these progenitor cells of the myeloid series, they are initially present, but later on there is a fibrosis, and therefore it is included in the myeloproliferative neoplasia, but at the end. The classification of the myeloproliferative disorders are the classic disorders and the atypical disorders. The classic disorders are Philadelphia chromosome positive, which is the CML or chronic myeloid leukemia, and Philadelphia negative, which include polycythemia vera, essential thrombocythemia, and chronic idiopathic myelofibrosis. And the other atypical disorders are chronic neutrophilic leukemia, and similarly chronic eosinophilic leukemia and chronic mast cell leukemia. I have already mentioned a few words that the abnormal proliferation of the neutrophil will be producing the neutrophilic leukemia, and abnormal proliferation of the eosinophil will be producing the hyper eosinophilic syndrome or hyper eosinophilic leukemia. And similarly, the mast cell abnormal proliferation will produce the systemic or localized mastocytosis. These myeloproliferative disorders are interrelated, and eventually all the myeloproliferative disorders, they end up by transforming into the acute myeloblast leukemia. You see, this is the acute myeloblastic leukemia. Chronic myeloid leukemia can transform into the acute myeloblastic leukemia. Similarly, polycythemia vera can transform into or complicate into the acute myeloblastic leukemia, and myelofibrosis can also complicate into the acute myeloblastic leukemia. Essential thrombocytosis in 2% of the cases can also transform into the acute myeloblastic leukemia. Now, since all these disorders, they are finally they end up with the acute myeloblastic leukemia. If they all these diseases are refractory to treatment, or they refuse the treatment to be cleared off by the treatment. That is why the acute myeloblastic leukemia is the eventuality. But the two disorders, essential thrombocytosis and polycythemia rubra vera, they also can complicate into the myelofibrosis. But again, myelofibrosis ultimately is complicated or transformed into the acute myeloblastic leukemia. So remember one thing, that in the myeloproliferative disorder, you may find the patient at a stage at which the patient has already gone into the acute myeloblastic leukemia phase. In that phase, the diagnosis, though, will be difficult for you, but you should keep your eye open that maybe that the underlying disorders behind the acute myeloblastic leukemia may be polycythemia vera, myelofibrosis and essential thrombocytosis, and similarly the CML. I mean, all the myeloproliferative disorders may be hidden behind the acute myeloblastic leukemia. That was the purpose of showing this slide, that all ultimately or penultimately they transform into the acute myeloblastic leukemia. All myeloproliferative disorders have common characteristics, and they are overproduction of one or several blood elements, but with predominance or preponderance of a transformed one clone of cells. There may be hypercellular marrow or may be the marrow fibrosis. These cytogenetic abnormalities are certainly present in all the myeloproliferative disorders, but they are different in every disease. And similarly, the patient may have either thrombosis or hemorrhagic presentation. There is increased cell turnover in all these disorders, leading on to hyperuricemia. And extramedullary or EMH is a feature of all the myeloproliferative disorders. And finally, the transformation to acute leukemia, which I mentioned earlier in this slide, that all myeloproliferative disorders can transform into the acute myeloblastic leukemia. And that is why they have overlapping clinical features, because sometimes a combination of both of them is there, or sometimes they both are present simultaneously, but one is predominant, the other one is less predominant. That is why we say that these diseases are myeloproliferative disorders. They are grouped under the same heading, because they have overlapping features. And sometimes earlier I explained that they sometimes a combination of two of them may be there, but the two may be have weaker role in the overall disease scenario, and one disease may be a leading disease, and the leading disease will be the final diagnosis if there are two or three are present simultaneously, but the leading one will be your final diagnosis, because all these cells are produced from the myeloid series, and they have the same progenitor cell. Therefore, sometimes they divide into different classes, and they have an overlapping feature because of the implication of 1, 2, 3 diseases in the same disorder, myeloproliferative disorder. Now, these are the features which will make the picture clear, that how do you proceed when you have to diagnose the disease, that which one of the disease is your diagnosis amongst the myeloproliferative disorders. Now you see the features which you will be noting down. They include leukocytosis, thrombocytosis, splenomegaly, lab scoring, marrow fibrosis, chromosome, Philadelphia chromosome, and JAK2 mutation V617F. So, meaning thereby that your diagnosis will be based on the characteristics which are some of which are clinical presentation, other are the laboratory diagnosis, and other are the cytogenetic abnormalities or immunophenotyping in which you find the gene mutations or surface markers on the cells. Now in CML you see the preponderant features will be that there will be huge leukocytosis, and similarly there will be massive splenomegaly, and Philadelphia chromosome will be positive. Since we have already discussed the CML and CLL in a separate lecture, therefore we will won't be discussing CML in this group of disorders, which is known as MPN or myeloproliferative neoplasia. Now next is polycythemia vera. You see in this disease the hematocrit, which will be you looking in this CBC only, the hematocrit will be very high, and the other predominant feature in the PVV will be that the patient will be having a JAK2 mutation, which of course will be checked by the immunophenotyping or the FISH test, or simply you write down to the laboratory that check the JAK2 mutation. They check the JAK2 mutation, and JAK2 mutation is known as because it is named after the genus and kinase enzymes. Therefore, you write it down as JAK2 mutation. So, this is of course a sort of cytogenetic test in which you check the mutations in the gene. So, JAK2 mutation and high hematocrit, they will favor the diagnosis of polycythemia vera. The essential thrombocytosis will be diagnosed. The patient will be having a very high number of the thrombocytes, and the cutoff value with the closed eyes, that if the patient have 1 million platelets in the circulation, 10 lakh per cubic meter, or 10 lakh into overall figure, 10 lakh or 1 million platelets are found on CBC examination simply. And second feature, that the patient may have a weaker JAK2 mutation also, but a stronger JAK2 mutation will favor the polycythemia vera. Now you can see that the JAK2 mutation is also present in essential thrombocytosis, but it is preponderantly present or strongly positive in case of polycythemia vera. So essential thrombocytosis is easy to diagnose because the patients on CBC, the patient's platelet count will be more than 1 billion. The diagnosis is very simple. And the next one is CIMF or chronic myelofibrosis, in which the patient will have again massive splenomegaly, and there will be a bone marrow examination. So this is an invasive test also involved in this characteristics of the myeloproliferative disorders. As I had said earlier, some clinical features will be we have grouped in this characterization, some scorings, some mutations, and some karyotyping or chromosomal analysis. So mutations, chromosomal analysis, bone marrow fibrosis, lab index, and further the clinical features. They, by a combination of all of these features, the diagnosis is established. So in chronic myelofibrosis, the patient will again be having massive fibrosis and massive splenomegaly. Certainly the bone marrow fibrosis will be finalized with the help of the bone marrow biopsy. Now, treatment of the myeloproliferative disorders, common characteristics among is that the curative treatment options for patient up to 75 years of age consist of first the conditioning protocols, and finally the allogenic bone marrow transplantation or stem cell transplantation. This is the ultimate treatment when you have exhausted all earlier easy treatments, which are molecular inhibitors, which are the targeted therapies such as tyrosine kinase inhibitor or metinib mesylate in case of CML. And the palliative treatment includes supportive care, in which the The conventional chemotherapy like hydroxyurea is being given today, even now, because it reduces the size of the spleen. And you can add on radiotherapy, and you can make use of the interferons or cytokines. They are now, though they are specific treatments, but yet they are headed under the palliational treatment because they don't have a curative capability. And you have to go to finally to the allogenic stem cell transplantation, allogenic bone marrow transplantation, or stem cell transplantation, which is the final treatment. Now, first of all, the polycythemia vera, the definition is that it is a neoplastic stem cell disorder possessing JAK2 mutation, which leads to excessive production of all myeloid cells, but preponderantly the red cell neoplasia is there. Again, I define that it is a condition in which the excessive production of RBCs with JAK2 mutation and other myeloid cells may also be present in this polycythemia rubra vera. Pathology of the PRV. First, the bone marrow examination. Initially, it may be hypercellular with this distinct proliferation of all the three cell lineages with emphasis on the erythrocytes. I have said the same lines earlier, that when you examine the bone marrow, initially it will be hypercellular, having all the other cell lines like RBCs, WBCs and platelets. But preponderantly, the erythropoiesis will be there. I mean, the RBCs will be keep on producing. Later on, as the disease advances, it goes into the fibrosis. Now, on peripheral smear examination, the patient will be having normocytic, normochromic anemia, hematocrit will be high, thrombocytosis may be there in 50% of the cases. Again, I have categorically stated here that thrombocytosis is also there, though it is not essential thrombocytosis, and that is the reason that these MPNs have been given as MPN to these disorders, because they have an integration of each other, one intrudes into the other. I mean, in the polycythemia vera, the thrombocytosis is also there. So therefore, you may be disguised, you may be cheated, and you are in a fix which one is the diagnosis. And the characteristics I have mentioned you in the above slide, that with the help of the criteria or guidelines or characteristics, you will be deciding the diagnosis of the disease. And the patient can have neutrophilia and basophilia also on the peripheral smear examination. The clinical features are very simple. The patient may have erythematous face known as plethora, and the patient may have cyanosis of the lips. The patient may have vertigo or dizziness, headache, tinnitus also, and the patient may have decreased vision or visual acuity, and this is grouped as hyperviscosity syndrome. The patient may have other features of the malignancy, which include asthenia or fatigue, weakness, reduced performance of the status. Patient may have fever and night sweats, and weight loss may also be there. And similarly, the patient may have vascular symptoms, which include transient ischemic attacks, intermittent claudication. I mean, one can imagine when the patient walks, he complains of cough cramps, and when he takes rest, the cough cramp is improved, and we call it as intermittent claudication. And you will hardly be visualizing that this patient might be a case of polycythemia vera. So you go and check the CBC, and you may find that the patient have a high hematocrit and the patient's hemoglobin is say 20 gram per deciliter. So then you will be checking the RBC mass. Similarly, the patient can also have Raynaud's phenomenon because of the overproduction of the RBCs and blocking the red cells. The patient may have bleeding from the duodenal stomach and stomach ulcer and esophageal varices and epistaxis. This is because in the polycythemia vera, there is also production of the platelets, but these platelets are abnormal, and these abnormal platelets, they don't play their proper role in the coagulation cascade. Therefore, the patient can bleed also. And one never thinks, hardly thinks, that the patient who has presented to you with the bleeding problem, and say epistaxis, menorrhagia, bruisability, etc., or bleeding with the injuries, you will be thinking on the lines of the bleeding disorders or coagulation disorders, but actually the underlying etiology is polycythemia vera, because the patient has got the abnormal production of the platelets, and these dysfunctional, defunct or abnormal platelets, they can cause bleeding because they don't play a role properly in the coagulation pathway. Then the patient can have hepatosplenomegaly because of the extramedullary hematopoiesis. The patient can have a very classic feature, pruritus in the polycythemia vera. That pruritus is because of the huge number of the RBCs. These RBCs, they produce histamine, and histamine release from the RBCs produces itching or pruritus. And especially this pruritus will be found, or itching will be found, when the patient takes a hot shower. I mean, when he takes a hot bath, the patient will come out of the bath with the itching and itching. And he will be in a fix, what has happened to me? Actually, you check the CBC and you will be finding that the patient have high hematocrit and the patient have high hemoglobin level, and then you will go for the other diagnostic options of the polycythemia vera, which are peculiar or specific for the same disease. Then the patient will be having erythromelalgia, in which the patient will be having burning of hands and feet. Now the laboratory investigations include CBC, already mentioned, the patient's hematocrit will be very high, the patient erythrocyte number will be very high, platelet number may be increased, granulocyte number may be increased, because they all originate from the same myeloid series of the cells. Then the other abnormalities or biochemical tests include that the patient can have hyperuricemia because of the increased cell turnover. Similarly, LDH may be high, vitamin B12 may be high, serum iron is low, and serum ferritin is low. Then the lab scoring or leukocyte alkaline phosphatase is very high in this case, and this also favors the diagnosis. The erythropoietin levels are decreased in the PRV or polycythemia vera, because they are increased in the secondary polycythemia. And finally, the mutation I have mentioned, JAK2 mutation or Janus kinase, tyrosine kinase mutation status with V617F. This is classic diagnostic test of the polycythemia vera. Then you go for the differential diagnosis. You have to differentiate in the PRV. You have to differentiate the PRV from secondary polycythemia, which includes dehydration. I mean, the secondary polycythemia may be because of the dehydration, pulmonary or cardiac diseases, sleep apnea syndrome, smoking, high adaptation. I mean, the patients who are living at greater heights, especially, they should be living at greater than 2000 meter heights. And hemoglobinopathies also fall under the purview of differential diagnosis of the polycythemia vera, and similarly the methemoglobinemia. The other states in which the erythropoietin is very high, they also be mistaken for the polycythemia vera. But actually, when you find that the erythropoietin level is high, then you forget about the PRV, and then you consider the secondary polycythemia. And these disorders include renal disorders, because the kidney produces high erythropoietin. Similarly, the paraneoplastic syndrome, I mean the renal cell carcinoma, cerebellar hemangioblastoma, lung cancers, and pheochromocytoma. These cancers can produce high amount of erythropoietin, and you will have to check the level of erythropoietin in serum. When it is high, then your diagnosis will be secondary polycythemia instead of polycythemia vera. the complications of the polycythemia are hypertension, hypervolemia with hyperviscosity, and pathological microcirculation, especially in the lungs, the brain, and the kidneys. Remember that the pathological microcirculation can lead on to the pulmonary disease, cerebral disease, and renal disorders. And these, the patient may have hypervolemia with hyperviscosity syndrome, which I have earlier mentioned in the clinical presentation of the polycythemia vera. Then the thromboembolic event or hemorrhage. Now, earlier said that the platelets may be increased in the 50% of the cases, and when some of them are normal, the patient may have thrombosis. But most of the times, the platelets are abnormal, therefore the patient will be having hemorrhagic presentation. Similarly, the patient will be having development of the osteomyelofibrosis. I mean, the bone marrow is fibrous, and similarly, this fibrosis, it will invade the bone also. So that is why we call as the osteomyelofibrosis. Then finally, all these myeloproliferative disorders, they transform into acute leukemia. The treatment, phlebotomy, one unit of the blood is removed weekly until the hematocrit is 45. Remember that you have to maintain the hematocrit less than 45%, and it is maintained by 40% as and when required. When it is higher, you do the phlebotomy and bring it down to less than 45%. Then the chemotherapy, and the chemotherapy is done with the help of the hydroxyurea. This tablet, hydroxyurea, is available with the name of Hydria, and its dose is variable depending upon the level of the polycythemia vera. However, I have used in many patients the dose ranging from 500 mg TDS to BD to OD to weekly to sometimes twice a week, sometimes once a week, depending upon the levels of the hemoglobin and the depending upon the level of hematocrit. Keep an eye on the percentage of the hematocrit. If the hematocrit is responding, say, with one tablet BD and it remains below 45%, maintain that dose. Otherwise, it is higher, found to be higher on the next CBC examination, you can titrate the dose upward, downward. Then, final drug is ruxolitinib, which is available with the name of Jakafi, and it is used in those cases of polycythemia vera which are non-responders to the Hydria or hydroxyurea. Its job is to reduce the spleen size. I mean, splenomegaly is reduced with the help of the ruxolitinib. Then the symptomatic treatment, pruritus, you can offer very easily antihistaminic drugs, H2 receptor inhibitors, cholestyramine, serotonin reuptake inhibitors, very easy to treat. Hyperuricemia can be treated with the help of the allopurinol, and thrombocytosis, the supportive drug is aspirin or acetyl salicylate 100 mg daily. And anagrelide can be used with the dose of 0.5 to 1 mg per day. It is an antiplatelet drug, and it is helpful to avoid the thrombocytosis. Similarly, erythromelalgia is helped by acetyl salicylic acid 100 mg per hour daily, and it can cause the reduction of the platelet count. Now you see the clinical manifestations. The patient is having erythromelalgia of the hands and feet, and it is known as Mitchell's disease. It is because of the blockage of the peripheral vessels, and the patient presents with pain, hyperemia, inflammation, and itching. This is a classic presentation of the cases of the polycythemia vera, and this is the plethora again because of the same underlying mechanism. And when you check the CBC, you see the CBC is flooded with the peripheral smear, is flooded with the RBC, RBC, RBC all around. These are all RBCs, you can see all RBCs, only rarely you have small platelets, so there is huge or flood of the RBCs in the peripheral smear, which is, we will be favor the diagnosis of the polycythemia vera and making the job easier for the pathologist and the physician. Next one is the essential thrombocythemia. First of all, the definition, it is a hematopoietic stem cell disease with clonal expansion of the thrombocytosis, thrombocytopoiesis and thrombocytosis. The patient will be having minimally the count should be greater than 450,000 per microliter, or when the patient is having the count greater than 1 million, you can say with confidence and with the closed eyes that the patient is having essential thrombocytosis. Clinical picture or features, initially the patient may be asymptomatic and the diagnosis is done by chance, and the symptoms are due to the thrombocytic complications, and which may include weight loss, patient may have mild fever, patient may present to you with the sweating or pruritus also, and the patient may have cerebral, cardiac or peripheral arterial thrombosis. So this is the alarming situation when the patient, some patient present to you with the arterial thrombosis, so you have to keep an eye that this is a case of thrombophilia and that the involvement is of the arteries rather than the venous. So you have to review all the causes of the thrombophilia or thrombosis, and you have to diagnose, and the job is easier when you check the CBC and the platelet count is very high, ranging from 5 lakh to 1 million, then JOMS, the diagnosis, you are half approach to the diagnosis. Similarly, the patient can have deep vein thrombosis of the legs, pulmonary thrombosis and the pulmonary emboli, and the patient can also have hemorrhage. And I mentioned earlier that though the number of the platelets is very high, but they are dysfunctional and they can produce the hemorrhage by their failure in the coagulation cascade role. The patient can have splenomegaly in majority of the cases, and similarly the patient can have skin manifestations ranging from erythromelalgia, which means the burning feet syndrome, ischemic acrocyanosis, and even sometimes the patient can present to you with the gangrene, and it may mimic as if the patient is suffering from the diabetic foot. And you can also keep in mind that sometimes the patient with vasculitis or vasculitis can produce with the gangrenous toes. So keep in mind that the essential thrombocytosis can also present sometime with the gangrene. The lab studies, the patient CBC will be, thrombocytosis will be very high, ranging from 5 lakh to 10 lakh or 1 million. Then routine other tests, LDH is usually high, serum potassium is high, and sometimes there is a pseudo hyperkalemia due to potassium release from the platelets. The lab score may be normal or mildly increased. Then you check the platelet function test and the bleeding time. Finally, the JAK2 mutation, it may be positive, but it not be JAK2 mutation, it not be as strongly positive as in case of polycythemia. When you are having the JAK2 mutation, then you have to, because you have to diagnose the disease, then you go for the other options, which include the CALR gene mutation. The CALR gene mutation is found in myeloproliferative disorders, especially the essential thrombocytosis, and this CALR gene mutation is the one in which there is a production of CAR reticulin protein in the in the cells and the especially the endoplasmic reticulum of the cells. And the collar is named after the computerized assisted legal research. Because this collar reticuline or collar gene mutation was recognized by the computerized assisted legal research team. Then the MPL gene mutation will consolidate your diagnosis of essential thrombocytosis in the setting when the patient is already having the JAK2 mutation and you are confused whether the diagnosis is polycythemia vera or whether the diagnosis is essential thrombocytosis. So collar and MPL gene myeloproliferative disorder gene mutation will help you. Now in MPL gene or myeloproliferative gene, the protein formed is one in which the serine amino acid is replaced by the aspargine gene. So replacement of the amino acid serine by the aspargine amino acid will detect the MPL gene mutation or myeloproliferative gene mutation. So when these collar and MPL gene mutations are present, then the diagnosis will be in favor of the essential thrombocytosis. The differential diagnosis of the essential thrombocytosis includes other myeloproliferative disorders, CML, myelofibrosis and polycythemia vera and myelodysplastic syndrome. Now this is a difficult diagnosis in the setting of the myeloproliferative disorders which we are studying today, but anyhow you can find in myelodysplasia anemia because of the reduced number of the RBCs being produced in the bone marrow. You can find patient can present to you with the bleeding because of the thrombocytopenia, and ultimately you can find the extramedullary hematopoiesis in which there will be hepatosplenomegaly, and sometimes the lymph nodes are also found. And mind you, splenomegaly is found in about 20% of the cases of the myelodysplastic syndrome. Now then the secondary thrombocytosis. The name is indicative that it is not a primary thrombocytosis. Actually we are studying the primary thrombocytosis. By secondary I mean then other causes may be any causes like following splenectomy, chronic iron deficiency or anemia, hemolytic anemia, blood losses and acute phase reaction to infections, the chronic infections, then autoimmune diseases like SLEs, other tumors or malignancies, vasculitis and allergic reactions. They all can lead to reactive thrombocytosis. All those states in which there is one or two cells are lost, the RBCs are lost or WCs are lost, the patient can have as a reaction increased number of platelets. We call it as a reactive thrombocytosis or secondary thrombocytosis. The diseases are listed here. The treatment options are observe the patient, first offer the patient aminosalicylic acid, then consider the hydroxyurea, the same drug we use in the polycythemia vera. The dose again is variable depending upon the levels of the thrombocytes in the circulation after repeated investigations. Then anagrelide is a dipyridamole analog. It inhibits the phosphodiesterases and phospholipases and leading to inhibition of the megakaryopoiesis and the thrombosis. So in fact it is an antiplatelet drug. It is also used in the heart diseases, and it is also used here because so that the increased number of platelets, they do not produce thrombosis. Then the interferons can also use in the treatment of the essential thrombocytosis. The dose is 3 to 5 million units, million international units, subcutaneous 3 times a week. And the pegylated interferons have been used what at a reduced dose compared to its utility in the hepatitis C and hepatitis B, where its dose is 180 microgram weekly, and in case of essential thrombocytosis, the dose is again reduced compared. Both of the interferons are reduced at used as the reduced doses in the essential thrombocytosis compared to their dose in the treatment of the hepatitis C. Now they have been outclassed today. They have become obsolete because of the invention of the oral antiviral therapies of the hepatitis C and B. Then phosphorus 32 is also an excellent drug which is helps a lot in the treatment of the thrombocytosis. Finally, the ruxolitinib or Jakafi, which is anti-JAK2 drug. Jakafi or ruxolitinib is anti-JAK2 drug, and it is a final treatment option in the treatment of the essential thrombocytosis. Now you see the peripheral smear in which there are platelets. You see they are all platelets, and in the huge in abundance there are lines of the RBCs, and in between the lines of the RBCs there are lines of the platelets. So they are in abundance here and here. You all can see that these are the platelets in abundance. So this is simply diagnosed with the help of the peripheral smear. So abundance of platelets. Again, the patient can have thrombocytosis, and when you see with the help of the cross section of the vessel, see these are clumps of the platelets here. Again, the clumps of the platelets here. Again, the platelets here, and the patient's actually experiences tiredness, lightheadedness, headache, and there is decreased visual acuity. I mean some features of the hyperviscosity syndrome, but actually the patient is suffering from essential thrombocytosis or thrombocythemia. Last disease in the polycythemia is chronic idiopathic myelofibrosis. Definition: it is a malignant stem cell disease with bone marrow fibrosis and successive suppression of the hematopoietic active bone marrow. Now you see, he is speaking of the two points. First one is fibrosis, and second one is the suppression of the active bone marrow production. So these are the hallmark feature of the idiopathic myelofibrosis, which fall under the purview of the definition of the myelofibrosis. And other way around, you can define that there is hyperplasia of the megakaryocyte, which produces platelet-derived growth factor. So this PDGF or platelet-derived growth factor, it produces myelofibrosis, myeloid metaplasia, and extramedullary hematopoiesis. Symptoms and signs: initially the patient may be asymptomatic and often diagnosed incidentally or accidentally, and when you check the bone marrow, you will be finding there will be hypermetabolic symptoms, reduced performance status, anorexia, weight loss, fever, and night sweats. But these symptoms are produced when the bone marrow fibrosis advances and the normal hematopoiesis decreases. These symptoms will be produced at that stage of the disease. Then the patient will be having anemia, weakness, fatigue, decreased performance, and patient may have leukopenia, and with the leukopenia, patient will be presenting it to you with the fever or infection like mucositis, etc. The patient may have thrombocytopenia, and the patient may have tendency to bleed from the GI tract, and the patient may have petechiae also. The patient is likely to have splenomegaly and hepatomegaly because of the extramedullary hemopoiesis or EMH. Remember the term EMH, extramedullary hemopoiesis. It is almost present in all the myeloproliferative neoplasia or myeloproliferative disorder. You can speak with closed eyes that the what are the causes of the hepatosplenomegalies. Don't forget to name the myeloproliferative disorders, including myelofibrosis. Now the laboratory analysis or laboratory findings, the patients are invariably anemic at presentation. The white blood count is variable, it may be low, normal or elevated. The platelet count is again variable. The peripheral smear is dramatic. Actually the peripheral picture is almost pathognomonic of the myelofibrosis. You may have coagulocytosis, you may have teardrop cells, you may have nucleated RBCs, and the patient may have left shift, and the platelet morphology may be bizarre shaped, and sometimes the giant degranulated platelets are found, or mega karyocyte fragments may also be seen. Now when you find a combination of teardrop cells or coagulocytes, leukoerythroblastic picture and giant abnormal platelets, this triad is highly suggestive of the myelofibrosis, highly suggestive, or I say the almost the pathognomonic of the myelofibrosis. The bone marrow ureal cannot be aspirated because there is dryness or fibrosis. Though early in the course of the disease, it is hypercellular with a marked increase in the megakaryocytes. If at all there are more cells in the bone marrow, they will be megakaryocytes. But fibrosis at this stage is detected by a silver staining technique, and which demonstrates the increased reticulin fibers. So silver, when you do the bone marrow biopsy, you do the silver staining also, and with the silver staining you will be picking the reticulin fibers in the which are actually the underlying fibers in the fibrosis of the bone marrow. Then later biopsy reveals more severe fibrosis with eventual replacement of the hematopoietic precursors by the collagen. So collagen can also be found on the bone marrow biopsy, collagen fibers. There is no characteristic chromosomal abnormality. JAK2 mutation may be found in the CIMF chronic inflammatory chronic idiopathic myelofibrosis in majority percent of the cases. Other investigation includes, you go for the ultrasound, you will be finding massive splenomegaly. You get on the MRI of the bone, you will be finding the signs of the myelofibrosis. And you, if you do the X-ray of the bone, the density of the bone will be changed because of the fibrosis actually invading from inside and involving the bone. Therefore, the density of the bones will be reduced. And in some time when the fibrosis is advanced stage, the density may be remarkably decreased on X-ray findings. The differential diagnosis of the CIML or chronic idiopathic myelofibrosis are CML, chronic myeloid leukemia, essential thrombocytosis, polycythemia vera. I mean all other myeloproliferative disorders, they are the contenders of the CI, chronic idiopathic myelofibrosis, CIMF. Then aplastic anemia, because aplastic anemia you can have a dry tap, and sometimes the bone marrow metastasis from other malignancies can convert the marrow into the similarity of the aplastic, because the only the cancer cell be present, actually the RBCs, WBCs and platelets will be lacking. So that is why the bone marrow metastasis also they fall under the heading of the differential diagnosis of the CIMF. Then the chronic infections, especially the miliary tuberculosis going into the bone marrow, and histoplasmosis involving the bone marrow, they are also the the differentials of the myelofibrosis. Now the treatment options. Anemia is treated with the help of the transfusions. Anemia can also be controlled with the androgens, prednisone, thalidomide or lenalidomide. First line therapy for myelofibrosis associated splenomegaly is hydroxyurea, which is effective in reduction of the spleen size about in 40% of the patients. Then radiation therapy also has a role in painful sites of the extramedullary hematopoiesis, especially the pulmonary hypertension and when the patient is having severe bony pains. Then transjugular intrahepatic portosystemic stent or TIPS might also be considered to alleviate symptoms of the portal hypertension. Then splenectomy is considered if the patient is having signs of hypersplenism and these signs of hypersplenism are non-responder to the above mentioned drugs like hydroxyurea, radiation, etc. Then finally the immunomodulatory medications, which are lenalidomide and pomalidomide. They result in control of the anemia in 25% of the patients and thrombocytopenia in 58% of the cases without significant reduction in spleenic size. There are several JAK2 inhibitors which are available and in all the diseases of this group, myeloproliferative disorders, ruxolitinib has been mentioned as a final authoritative treatment. So again here it comes to our rescue in the essential thrombocytosis, ruxolitinib. It is a JAK2 inhibitor and you see the treatment with the ruxolitinib can exacerbate cytopenia. It results in reduction of the spleen size and there are constitutional symptoms improvement and it may lead to an overall survivor benefit in patients with intermediate high risk disease. So when the patient is high risk, it comes to the rescue of the patient. The only potentially curative option for this disease is allogeneic stem cell transplantation in selected number of patients and you will have to find the matching sibling or sometimes the non-sibling but matching. So the final treatment is allogeneic stem cell transplantation. I suspect some of you are sleeping. Please wake up and you can ask me any question pertaining to the myeloproliferative disorders, including repeating again, polycythemia vera, essential thrombocytosis and chronic idiopathic myelofibrosis. Thank you from Akshay Trust Hospital. I will be waiting for your feedback and any suggestions so that we can improve upon ourselves in the online teaching. I say goodbye from Akshay Trust Hospital.